Good evening, my dear children. Hope you all are fine by God's grace. And hope you are studying well at home. Please go through the topics we are taking daily. Okay, so that you can write well in your sessional examination as well as in the university examination. So today I am going to start with the cardiovascular system. And the first condition is rheumatic fever. Okay, rheumatic fever. So, acute rheumatic fever is an acute autoimmune disease that occurs as a sequelae of group A beta hemolytic streptococcal infection. It is characterized by inflammatory lesions of the connective tissues and endothelial tissues, primarily affecting the joints and heart. Okay, it is acute rheumatic fever is an acute autoimmune disease. It is an autoimmune disease. That is, the immune system itself is reacting to the physiological systems of our own body. Okay, so it is an autoimmune disease and it is affecting as a sequelae. That means there is a group of infections is happening in the rheumatic fever because of the infection of group A beta hemolytic streptococcal infection. So it is characterized by inflammatory lesions in the connective tissue and endothelial tissues. Primarily, it is affecting the joints and heart. So, rheumatic fever is an immunologically mediated inflammatory disorder which occurs as a sequel to group A beta hemolytic streptococcal infection or group A streptococcal infection to the pharynx. Okay, it's a sequelae of infection. That means primarily this infection is happening in the body as a pharyngitis or a pharyngeal infection. The causative organism is same as that of the rheumatic fever, that is group A beta hemolytic streptococcal. This group A beta hemolytic streptococcal infection of the pharynx will be sequeled or will be continued as rheumatic fever. So, multisystem disease affecting the connective tissue, particularly of the heart, joints, brain, cutaneous and subcutaneous tissue. So, this is a multisystem disorder. This rheumatic fever is a multisystem disorder which is affecting the heart, joints, brain, cutaneous and subcutaneous tissues. So, rheumatic fever, it is not a communicable disease. Okay. You may mistaken that this is a communicable disease, but this is not a communicable disease. This is not at all a communicable disease, but it is a result from a communicable disease, that is streptococcal pharyngitis. So, it is a result of a communicable disease, but this is entirely not a communicable disease. This is a sequelae of infection of another communicable disease known as streptococcal pharyngitis. So, the illness is so named because its similarity in presentation of rheumatism, that is, it is a similarity with the another condition called rheumatism. So the epidemiology are ages, that is 5 to 15 years are more susceptible to get this rheumatic fever. Then there it is rare in less than 3 years of age. Then the girls are more affected than boys, and environmental factors like overcrowding, poor sanitation and poverty are much important. They are the important factors. They are the environmental factors that causes rheumatic fever. The incidence is more during the rainfall, that is rainy season, winter season and early spring season. So, pathophysiology and etiology. So, most first attacks of acute rheumatic fever occur 1 to 5 weeks. That is average. There is an average of 3 weeks. After a streptococcal infection of the throat or the upper respiratory tract, that is, if there is an upper respiratory tract infection or any streptococcal pharyngitis, the first attack of acute rheumatic fever will occur within 1 to 5 weeks after the primary infection or after the primary streptococcal pharyngitis, this rheumatic fever will occur. And the peak incidence occurs in children ages 6 to 15 years. The incidence after a mild streptococcal pharyngeal infection is 0.3% and after a severe streptococcal infection is 1 to 3%. So there are only 1 to 3% chance. That means if the streptococcal pharyngitis is well treated, there is not a chance for the recurrence of rheumatic fever. So the chance is only 1 to 3%. So the family history of rheumatic fever is also positive. Then Group A streptococcal pharyngeal infection precedes clinical manifestation of acute rheumatic fever by 2 to 6 weeks. That means I have already told you that within 2 to 6 weeks manifestations will be we can clearly see the manifestations in the child after group A streptococcal pharyngeal infection, but only it will be in 1 to 3% of cases. Then the body produces antibodies. That means I have already told you that it is an autoimmune disorder. So the body produces antibodies against the streptococci. But here the antibodies cross react. That means there will be a mechanism called molecular mimicry. Molecular mimicry means it will cross react with the human tissues because of the antigenic similarity. That means there will be an antigenic similarity between streptococcal components and human connective tissue. The streptococcal components of the organism group A beta hemolytic streptococci, the components that is contained in the group A beta hemolytic streptococci and the connective tissue are similar. So in some cases the body may destroy this connective tissue by mistakening that it is the product of the streptococci. Are you clear with the process? That means this is known as an autoimmune disorder because the body will destroy the connective tissue. That is, the body destroy their own connective tissue by mistaking that it is the component or it is the antigen produced by the streptococci. Okay, this is happening. This the destruction of the connective tissue of our body itself is happening because in some cases our body may mistaken that our body may get a confusion that this streptococci antigen and the connective tissue are similar. Okay, there are certain similarity in the components of the connective tissue of our body and the components of streptococci. So in that case the body may mistaken that the components of connective tissue are the microorganism and they will destroy the connective tissue of our body itself. This process is known as molecular mimicry. Next is immunologically mediated inflammation and damage to human tissues which have antigenic similarity with streptococcal components like heart, joint, and brain and connective tissues. That means the connective tissue of our heart, brain and joints are similar to that of the components of the streptococci organism. So in that case there will be autoimmune response in the body itself. So because of the similarity between hyaluronic acid and group A beta hemolytic streptococci capsule in the connective tissue of the joints, the antibody produced against the capsule will start attack the joints and cause arthritis. Okay, that means the hyaluronic acid there is a similarity in the antigens produced by the group A beta hemolytic streptococci and the components in the connective tissue. The similarity is that both the group A hemolytic streptococci as well as the connective tissue contains a common factor called hyaluronic acid. Okay, so in some cases the antibody that is produced by our body may mistaken the presence of the hyaluronic acid in the connective tissue and they may think that this connective tissue is a component of the streptococci and it will destroy the connective tissue of the heart, brain and joints and this will cause arthritis. Then in some cases the antibody may destroy the cell wall of the heart and will cause carditis. Similarly, the antibody against N-acetyl glucosamine is also the antigen produced by the organism. So it will mistake in the N-acetyl glucosamine and it will affect the cardiac valve tissue. That is, it will cause valvular damage. So in rheumatic fever, the damage will be causing to the valves, joints, then connective tissue of brain and heart. Next is pathological lesions. So fibrinoid degeneration of the connective tissue. The connective tissue will be degenerated to fibrinogens. And there will be inflammatory edema, inflammatory cell infiltration and proliferation of the specific cells, resulting in the formation of Ascoff nodules. Ascoff nodules resulting in pancarditis in the heart. arthritis in the joints. Okay, pancarditis means entire inflammation of all the layers of the heart. Then arthritis in the joints. Then Ascoff nodules can be seen in the subcutaneous tissues. Then basal ganglia lesions resulting in chorea. Chorea means involuntary jerky movements. Then streptococcal infection abates with or without treatment. However, autoantibodies attack the myocardium. That means even after the treatment or even after the suppression of the streptococcus that is present in our body will continue to produce antibodies, autoantibodies, and attack the myocardium, pericardium, and the cardiac valves. So the Ascoff body means fibrin deposit. This Ascoff body develop on the valves, possibly leading to permanent valve dysfunction, especially of the mitral and aortic valves. Okay, mitral valve is a valve that is present in the left side of the heart. That is, it is a valve that is connection between the left atrium and left ventricle. So the mitral valve damage as well as aortic valve dysfunction is happening because of the presence of this Ascoff bodies. Then severe myocarditis may cause dilatation of the heart and congestive heart failure. Then there will be streptococcal sore throat. That is, there will be tender lymph nodes in the throat. Then if the child is having close contact with the infected person, then there will be scarlet fever rashes all over the body. Then excoriated nails in the infants. That is, crusted lesions can be present inside the nose. Then tonsillar exudates in older children. Abdominal pain. Then the golden standard, that is, the positive throat culture. In rheumatic fever, we can do throat swab culture, and the positive standard is that the gold standard is that if throat culture is positive, we can confirm it as rheumatic fever. Then clinical manifestations are following the upper airway infection with group A beta hemolytic streptococcus. The silent period of 2 to 4 weeks, there will be sudden onset. After the streptococcal pharyngitis, there will be sudden onset of fever, pallor, malaise, and fatigue. Commonly, the group A beta hemolytic streptococcal infection is subclinical. Such cases confirmed using streptococcal antibody testing or throat swabbing. Then the major manifestation, then the clinical manifestations of the rheumatic fever is classified as major manifestations and minor manifestations, and it is commonly known as John's criteria. Okay, John's criteria. So in the John's criteria, the major manifestations are polyarthritis, carditis, Sydenham's chorea, erythema marginatum, and subcutaneous nodules. So first is polyarthritis. The most common feature present in 90% of the patients is polyarthritis, that is, inflammation of the multiple joints. Joint is arthritic, that is, inflamed, painful, migratory, short duration pain. Usually more than 5 joints are affected, and then mainly large joints like knees, ankles, wrist, elbow, and shoulders. Then the small joints in cervical spine are less commonly involved. Then excellent response to salicylates and non-steroidal and inflammatory drugs in case of polyarthritis. Then pain and swelling come on quickly and subsides within 5 to 7 days. Then in children below 5 years, arthritis usually mild, but carditis is more prominent. Then arthritis do not progress to chronic disease. The next is carditis. That is early and most serious infection. It is manifested as pancarditis, and it is occurring in 60 to 70% of cases. The carditis is the only manifestation of rheumatic fever that leaves a sequelae and permanent damage to the organ. So as a result of carditis, there will be permanent damage to the heart. Then valvular damage is the hallmark of rheumatic fever. And chronic phase, there will be fibrosis, calcification, and stenosis of the heart valves, and the heart valves will be like fish mouth valves. Fish mouth valve means, have you seen the mouth of the dead fish? It will be open. Okay, that is fish mouth valves. That is, the valves will be open always. Then next is Sydenham's chorea. It occurs in 5 to 10% of cases, mainly in girls of 1 to 15 years of age. The late manifestation of rheumatic fever after months of infection, it is a later manifestation. In Sydenham's chorea, there will be spasmodic, unintentional, jerky, choriform movements. Then the speech will be affected. Then choriform movements particularly affect the head. that is darting movement of tongue. There will be darting, the movement, the tongues will be clinging and upper limbs, then difficulty in walking, then talking, writing, and usually it will results in 2 to 3 months. Then next is erythema marginatum. It occurs in less than 7%. Unique transient serpiginous looking lesions, that means the skin will be similar to that of the skin of snake. It is 1 to 2 inch in size. The lesions will be 1 to 2 inch in size. Then pink macules, clear centrally, serpiginous spreading edge. Serpiginous means snake like. Then more on trunks and limbs, non itchy, almost never on face, worsens with application of heat, and often associated with chronic carditis. Then the next manifestation, in the major manifestation of John's criteria, is subcutaneous nodules. That is small, painless, mobile, hard lumps beneath the skin. Most common along the extensor surface of joint, knees, elbows and wrist. Also on bony prominences, tendons, dorsi of the feet, occiput or cervical spine, and appears 4 weeks after the onset of rheumatic fever. Then delayed manifestation disappears and leaves no residual damage. And it occurs in 9 to 20% of cases and often associated with carditis. The nodules are firm, non-tender, isolated or in clusters. So these are the major manifestations, John's criteria. Then next is minor manifestation. In minor manifestation, there will be history of previous rheumatic fever or evidence of pre-existing rheumatic heart diseases. Then arthralgia, pain in one or more joint without evidence of inflammation. Then tenderness or limited movement. Then fever, the temperature greater than 100 degree Fahrenheit. Then laboratory abnormalities like elevated erythrocyte sedimentation rate, positive C-reactive protein, elevated white blood cell count. Then ECG changes, prolonged PR interval. Okay, so these all are about the John's criteria. Then there are some supporting evidence of preceding streptococcal infection within the last 45 days. There will be some supporting evidence. We have to check for the manifestation after 45 days of infection. That means there will be elevated or rising anti-streptolysin. ASO titer will be elevated, anti-streptolysin O or other streptococcal antibody, a positive throat culture, rapid antigen test for group A streptococcus, then recent scarlet fever. So diagnostic evaluation, diagnosed clinically through use of the John's criteria from the American Heart Association. I have told already presence of 2 major manifestation or 1 major and 2 minor manifestation with supporting evidence of a recent streptococcal infection. Then ECG done to elevate the PR interval and other changes. Then laboratory test listed above. In addition, group A streptococcal culture or anti-streptolysin O titer to detect the streptococcal antibodies from recent infection. Then chest x-ray for cardiomegaly, pulmonary congestion or edema. The laboratory findings, high ESR, anemia, leukocytosis, elevated C-reactive proteins, and ASO titer greater than 200 TOD units. That is peak value attained at 3 weeks, then comes down to normal by 6 weeks. In throat culture for beta hemolytic streptococci. Then laboratory findings like ECG, prolonged PR interval, second and third degree blocks, ST depression, T inversion, then 2D echocardiography, we can see the valve edema, mitral regurgitation, then left atrial and left ventricular dilatation and decreased contractility. The management is, we can do the management in 4 steps, that is in first step primary prevention or eradication of streptococci, second step is anti-inflammatory treatment with aspirin and steroids, and step 3 is supportive management and management of complications, and step 4 is secondary prevention and prevention of recurrent attacks. So in the first step we can see the primary prevention. The aim of the treatment is prevent the first attack of rheumatic fever by identifying all the patients with streptococcal throat infection and treating them with penicillin. The penicillin treatment can be provided as a prevention. So the theoretically simple, in practice it's difficult, not visible. So many infections are inapparent or if apparent are not brought to attention by the health services. That means at the primary stage it is very difficult to find out the manifestations. Then viable approach, concentrate on high risk groups, that is school age children, surveillance for streptococcal pharyngitis. So at the primary prevention of rheumatic fever, the treatment includes we can give benzathine penicillin G 6 lakh unit for patients or 1 lakh 20 for patients in up to 27 kg, you can give 6 lakh units, or if the patients or if the children is above 27 kg, we can give double the dose, that is 12 lakh units. And it is a mode of insertion is intramuscular, and it the duration is once in a month. The next is penicillin V or phenoxymethyl penicillin. Here the children 250 mg 2 to 3 times daily oral for 10 days, and in adolescents and adults 500 mg 2 to 3 days daily oral for 10 days. So this is the both these both agents are the least expensive method. Then for individuals allergic to penicillin, some children are allergic to penicillin, in that case we can give erythromycin or estolate 20 to 40 mg per kg per day, 2 to 4 times daily, maximum 1 gram per day, the oral for 10 days, or ethyl succinate 40 mg per kg per day, 2 to 4 times daily, maximum 1 gram per day, oral for 10 days. Then step 2, anti-inflammatory treatment. So the condition and clinical conditions like arthritis and carditis, we can do anti-inflammatory treatment. The drugs in arthritis is aspirin, that is 75 to 100 mg per kg per day, give us 4 divided doses for 6 weeks, attain a blood level of 20 to 30 mg per dl. The next is carditis. In carditis we can give prednisolone 2 to 2.5 mg per kg per day, give us 2 divided doses for 2 weeks, then taper over 2 weeks, and while tapering add aspirin. That means in tapering means we have to stop it for 2 weeks, and while that in that period we have to give aspirin 75 mg per kg per day for 2 weeks, continue aspirin alone 100 mg per kg per day for another 4 weeks. And step 3 is supportive management and management of complications. So provide bed rest, treatment of congestive cardiac failure with digitalis and diuretics, then treatment of chorea with diazepam and haloperidol, then rest to joints and supporting splints. In step 4, the secondary prevention of rheumatic fever, we have to prevent the recurrent attacks. That means we can provide benzathylene penicillin G 120,000 units every 3 weeks intramuscularly, or penicillin V 250 mg twice daily orally. For individual allergic to penicillin and sulfadiazine, erythromycin 250 mg twice daily orally. Then duration of secondary rheumatic fever prophylaxis is, rheumatic fever, if the child is having, it is categorized into various category depending on the manifestations, secondary prevention. So here the rheumatic, if the child is having rheumatic fever without carditis, we can give the treatment for at least 5 years or until age 18 years, whichever is longer. The rheumatic fever with carditis and heart disease, that is persistent valvular disease, we can do the secondary treatment for at least 10 years since last residual episode, and at least until age 40 years, sometimes lifelong prophylaxis. And if the child is having rheumatic fever with carditis but no residual heart disease, then 10 year or well into adulthood, whichever is longer. Then most severe valvular disease and post valve surgery cases, we have to take the medication for lifelong. And complications are congestive heart failure, then pericarditis, pericardial effusion. Pericardial effusion means that means accumulation of the fluid around the heart, that is around the entire heart layer, that is in the pericarditis, in the pericardium. Then permanent damage to the aortic and mitral valve, possibly requiring valve replacement. The nursing assessment, assess for signs of cardiac involvement by auscultation of the heart, for murmur and cardiac monitoring for prolonged PR interval, then monitor pulse for 1 full minute to determine heart rate, assess the temperature for elevation, observe for involuntary movements, stick out tongue or smile, then garbled or hesitant speech when asked to recite numbers or ABCs, hyperextension of the wrist and fingers when trying to extend the arms. Then assess the child's ability to feed self, dress self, and do other activities if chorea or arthritis is present. Then assess pain level using scale appropriate for child's age. Then assess the parent's ability to cope with illness and care for the child. Assess need for homeschooling while patient is on bed rest. Then the nursing interventions are, if the child is having decreased cardiac output related to carditis, explain to the child and family the need for bed rest during the acute phase. Approximately 2 weeks there is need of bed rest. And as long as the congestive heart failure is present. Then in milder cases, light indoor activities allowed. Then in severe cases, organized care so that the child will not have to exert self and will have hours of uninterrupted rest. Then maintain cardiac monitoring if indicated, administering course of antibiotics if needed. Be alert to adverse effects such as nausea, vomiting and GI distress. Administer medications for congestive heart failure as directed. Monitor BP, intake and output chart and heart rate. Then acute and chronic pain related to arthritis. Administer anti-inflammatory medications, analgesics and antipyretics as directed. Monitor for signs of aspirin toxicity. There is chance of aspirin toxicity like tinnitus, nausea and vomiting and headache. Then monitor for signs of corticosteroid use like GI distress, acne, weight gain, emotional disturbances or long-term effects such as rounded face, ulcer formation and decreased resistance to infection. Then administer all anti-inflammatory medications with food to reduce the GI injury. Then be aware that anti-inflammatories may not alter the course of myocardial injury. Then teach the family the importance of maintaining dosage schedule, continuing a medication until all signs and symptoms of ARF have gone, and tapering the dose as directed by the healthcare provider. Then assist the child with positioning for comfort and protecting inflamed joints. Then suggest diversional activities that do not require use of painful joints. Then risk for injury related to chorea. Use padded side rails if chorea is severe. Assist with feeding and other fine motor activities as needed. Then assist with ambulation if they are weak. Then avoid the use of straws and sharp utensils if chorea involves the face. Then make sure that the child consumes nutritious diet with recommended vitamins, proteins and calories. Then be patient if speech is affected and offer emotional support. And protect the child from stress. Then administer phenobarbital and other medications for chorea as directed. Observe for drowsiness. Then family education and mental health maintenance. It is much important. Teach the appropriate administration of all medications including prophylactic antibiotics. Then encourage all family and household members to be screened for streptococcus and receive the appropriate treatment. Then instruct on additional prophylaxis for endocarditis with dental procedures and surgery as indicated. Then encourage family activity restrictions, resuming activity gradually and resting whenever tired. Then encourage keeping appointments for follow-up evaluation by cardiologists and other healthcare providers. Then advise the parents that child cannot return to school until healthcare provider assess that all the disease activity is gone. It is much important. The parents may need to discuss with teachers how the child can catch up with schoolwork. Then instruct on follow-up with usual healthcare provider for immunizations. Then well child evaluations, hearing and vision screening and other health maintenance needs. Then provide general health education about early identification and treatment, seeking for any possible streptococcal infection like fever and sore throat. Then compliance with 10 to 14 days of antibiotics can greatly reduce the risk of acute respiratory failure and other post-streptococcal sequelae. So these are all about the rheumatic fever and its management. Hope you all have understood my class, and if you have any doubt, you can ask me in the group. Please study well and go through the topics. Thank you.